this next bit, we will discuss various applications of logarithmic and exponential functions. In particular, some of the biggest applications in various real-life scenarios when it comes to logarithms are logarithmic scales. And there are quite a few of them that we use on an everyday basis. For example, a Richter scale for earthquake intensity or decibel scale for the volume of the sound are both logarithmic scales. So the Richter scale is defined to be log base 10, which many things in engineering, for example, are, of the ratio of the intensity of the current earthquake with respect to or divided by I naught, which is the intensity of a barely felt earthquake. So everything, every earthquake that the seismologists measure are actually compared to this threshold value. Okay, so for the first part, the question asks, if the earthquake is 10,000 times as intense as a threshold or barely felt earthquake, what is the magnitude of that on the Richter scale? So if something is 10,000 times bigger, what does that mean for the Richter scale? Okay, so let's take a look at this expression here that is giving us the intensity of the Richter scale of the current earthquake. So I'm going to have logarithm base 10 of the current earthquake divided by the magnitude of the threshold. Now I know that my current earthquake, or I, is 10,000 times as intense as the threshold. So I is 10,000 times the threshold amount, and I'm dividing this all by the threshold amount. So here I notice that my I naughts will cancel, and I'm simply going to have logarithm of base 10 of 10,000. Now, conveniently, 10,000 can be written as 10 to the power 4. So now I'm computing logarithm base 10 of 10 to the power 4. So what power do I have to raise 10 to get 10 to the 4th? Well, I can see the power right there. It's simply 4. So that means that the earthquake that is 10,000 times as intense as the threshold is actually 4 on Richter scale. And this is the power of logarithmic scales, is they take big numbers and turn them into more sensible numbers that are easier to compare. For part two of the question, the strongest earthquake that happened on record was in Chile in May 22, 1960, and its magnitude was recorded as 9.5. How much stronger was this earthquake than the threshold? Okay, so I am not interested in its Richter scale. I'm given its Richter scale, and I'm wondering about this ratio inside the logarithm. So I know that its own Richter scale, or it measured 9.5 on the Richter scale, and that, as per the definition of the Richter scale, is log base 10 of I divided by I naught. Now, I'm interested in this expression right here. So I'm interested in getting this from the inside of the logarithm, which of course means now that I have to take this entire expression and raise 10 to that power, because then according to the cancellation laws, 10 and logarithm of base 10 will, as functions, cancel each other out. Okay, so raising both sides to power 10, I'm going to get that 10 to power 9.5 is equal to I over I naught. So that gives me what I want to know. As compared to the barely felt earthquake, the earthquake in Chile was 10 to power 9.5 times stronger. Type that into the calculator and see how huge of a number that is. And that is the reason why something that is 10,000 versus something that is 10 to the power of 9.5 are going to be hard to compare versus numbers like 4 and 9.5. Logarithmic scales are just one of the many useful applications of logarithmic and exponential functions. For the next one, let's take a look at this one. Growth and decay models. We've been seeing a lot of modeling, mathematical modeling, in the news with the spread of the disease, right? So this is the simplest model where all of the epidemiology, for example, starts. The model is described as this. The amount of, let's say, bacteria present depends on the initial amount and some kind of growth, exponential growth rate. So this P naught is what we call the initial amount, and we will see why that's the case in a second. And then we're assuming exponential growth, or exponential decay. So things like population of bacteria or infection grow exponentially, whereas radioactive material, or the way that the drugs are absorbed into your system, decays exponentially, so decreases exponentially. So this K value is what we call growth or decay model, depending a constant, depending on whether the model is modeling growth or it's modeling decay. So let's first of all think about why is this called the initial amount. So what happens at time zero? Let's plug that in and see. If I plug in time equals zero, I'm going to get P naught e to power k times zero. Now, k times zero is just zero. E to power zero is simply one. So this entire thing turns into one. And I'm going to have P naught left. So in fact, when I plug in t equals zero, I simply get this coefficient, which is why it's called the initial amount. Now, we're going to have two different scenarios for the growth, where k is positive, and for the decay, where k is negative, the actual growth constant. So let's draw two graphs that correspond to each case. Okay, so for the positive k constant, it means that I actually have an exponential function with a positive exponent in it. I know that at time zero, I have some initial, let's say, number of bacteria or number of infected individuals, and then after that, my exponential takes off. So I'm going to draw the mathematical graph, which means I'm going to draw it for all values of t, although time, as usually is used in these applications, of course, is only going to be negative or positive, so I'm only interested in the positive side of the axis. For the k equals negative, recall that no matter what I plug into the exponential here, I'm never going to get the negative number as the output. I am simply going to have the graph that decreases but still has x-axis as its horizontal asymptote. So this is where I will have the decay, but I'm never going to end up with a negative amount of radioactive material, let's say, if it's decaying, or a negative amount of aspirin in the bloodstream after the drug has been taken. Okay, so the two situations are described by whether this constant k is positive or negative. So positive describes growth, negative describes the decay. And that is extremely useful as the very first attempt at modeling various complex scenarios. Let's take a look, for example, here at the population models of fish. So I have two populations that we're studying of fish in Caldas Lake, okay? And we're asked, what can you tell me about these simply based on the models? So are the populations growing? Are they declining? So let's take a look at the two populations. The model for the sturgeon population is given to us by this formula, and the rainbow trout is given by this formula. Okay, as we've discussed before, in each one of these formulas, the coefficient in front of the exponential corresponds to the initial population, which we have yet to receive the data for, but the actual exponents represent either growth or decay. So in the case of the sturgeon here, the exponent is negative, which means that the population will be declining. In the case of the rainbow trout here, the exponent, the constant in front of time variable, is positive, which means that overall the population will be growing or increasing. Okay, now the part B of this question gives us information about initial populations. So that means that I can put them into the corresponding spots and refine my models. So if I have for the sturgeon originally 500 fish, then my model can become 500 e to the negative 1.3 t. And for the rainbow trout, it will then be 300 e to the 1.7 t. The question then asks, at what time would the two populations be exactly equal? Well, the left side here gives me the population at the current time. So in order for me to have them equal, I simply have to have their models set to be equal. So now I have to solve the equation where both of the populations are at the same level. Okay, and here I have an equation. On both sides I have exponential functions. There are, as I've said before, a number of ways to calculate this and to solve this equation. I'm simply going to use one of the ways. I'm going to try to put all the numbers on one side and all the expressions that involve exponential functions onto the other side. Okay, so I'm going to divide both sides by 300, which will give me 500 over 300 here. And I'm also going to divide both sides by e to power negative 1.3t. So on the right hand side, on the left hand side that will cancel, but on the right hand side I will get this expression right here, e to the power 1.7t over e to the power minus 1.3t. Okay, let's try to simplify this further. So 500 over 300, that's 5/3. And on the right hand side, I know that if I have the same base, I can combine the powers. And division means I'm going to be subtracting. So 1.7t minus 1.3t will be a plus. So 1.7 plus 1.3 will result in 3t altogether. Now this is great news, because now that means that I have e to some power all by itself, and I can take logarithms of both sides. So my next step will be logarithm, or base e, 5/3 is logarithmic and exponential functions on the right will cancel each other out, so I'm going to have simply 3t. Solving for t here gives me ln of 5/3 all over 3, which, if you calculate, turns out to be about 0.17. Let's look up what the units are. Time is measured in years, so it's 0.17 years. Okay, exponential growth and exponential decay are pretty fast processes. So if you have exponents that are above 1, the growth and decay will really happen pretty quickly. For the next part, we're asked on the same set of axes to sketch the graphs of both of the populations. Okay, so we're going to sketch all of the information that we've derived above. So let's start with my axes. I'm going to sketch only what happens for positive time, because here in context the population grows with time. So my sturgeon population starts at 500 and my rainbow trout starts at 300. I know that the sturgeon population is declining, so I'm going to have a exponential function that is in the shape of decreasing function, and I know my rainbow trout population is growing, which means that this population has to be actually increasing. But I also know that they're in exact same value, in 0.17 years. Okay, so let's say I have a 0.17 years somewhere on this axis, and this is where I know both graphs have to be in the exact same spot, but I don't yet know in which spot it is. So notice that I can plug this value of t back into either one of these expressions to evaluate how many fish I'm actually expecting to have at this time. Okay, so plugging into either one of them should result in a number that is approximately the same, and yes, it's approximately 401 fish. So that means that my two graphs meet at the point at approximately 400 here. Okay, so now, keeping all of this in mind, and the fact that they're exponential, I know that this function will come down as an exponential. So I'm dashing, I have dashed lines before zero, because again, time does not go backwards like that. And I know that my second function will be increasing as an exponential, but I have to make sure that I also take it through the point where my two functions were allegedly the same. Okay, so something like this. This will then be a fairly good sketch of the situation between the two populations. I can see that past the point of equality, one of them will continue growing while the other one will continue decreasing. The other popular and important applications of exponential and logarithmic functions are that of radioactive decay. So this example centers on cesium-137 that in laboratory conditions is known to have a half-life of 30 years. Now, if we assume that the lab half-life is 30 years, is the same as in the actual real world, then we can calculate how much of the initial amount of cesium-137 remains in the soil of the Chernobyl areas affected in the 1986 accident. So let's set up the model, and the model will be as we have seen before. So the amount of radioactive element is the initial amount times e to the power of kt. Now we are given that the half-life is 30 years, which means that in 30 years after the explosion, so we take T0 to be at the day of the explosion, so in 30 years the amount will be reduced by half. This left-hand side represents the actual amount present in a certain time. So in 30 years, whatever we had originally or not will be halved. And the right-hand side in 30 years will simply acquire the value of 34T. So notice here that both sides have this value of R naught, which is not zero. So we can divide both sides by R naught and effectively cancel that out. So altogether now we're going to have that 1/2 is equal to e to the power of k times 30. Which means we can take logarithms of both sides and then divide everything by 30 to actually get at the k value. So this will be logarithm of 1/2 divided by 30, which turns out as a decimal to be approximately -0.0231. So a couple of things to notice here is that, first of all, this number comes out being negative, which means that in fact this is a decay model. The amount of radioactive element is decreasing. This number also comes out to be quite small, 0.02, and this is a common trend in all of these types of problems, is that the values of the constants are very small because exponential growth or decay is actually quite fast. So this is the actual k value, which means we can use this in our equation right here in order to then calculate how much of the initial amount still remains. So now in 2020, that is 34 years after 1986, which is when the accident has occurred. So we are simply calculating the amount in 34 years. The original amount, let's take it to be 100 as in percent. So we will be calculating the percentage of the remaining amount, times e to the power of k, which is -0.0231, times t, which is 34. Okay, so let me label these here just to be clear. This is k, this is t, and this we can plug into the calculator, and this comes out to be approximately 45.6% of the original amount. Okay, which makes sense, because if the half-life is 30 years, it's been 34 years. In 30 years, we expect there to be exactly a half of 50%. So in 34 years, we expect there to be less than that. Let's take a look at part B here, which says the data shows that while the lab half-life is 30 years, the actual amount in soil near Chernobyl is not decreasing as fast. We are asked to find the ecological half-life if the areas affected by the accident still contain 90.48% of the initial amount of cesium-137. So not 45.6 like the lab half-life will predict, but rather a much, much higher amount. Okay, so we will start with the same model. R of t is R naught e to the power of kt, except for I'm going to name my constant something else, let's say c in this case, just to indicate that I'm not actually expecting to see the exact same constant. Constant depends on the half-life, so this constant will be different as the half-life will be different. Here, the information I am given is something about the present day amount. So I will first of all start with now in 2020, which is 4t equals 34. What we have is that the present amount, which is described by this equation, is 90.48% of the original, and the original was 100%. E to power c, which we don't know the value for, times t, which is 34 in year 2020. So now I can solve for this constant c in this expression, and I'm going to have that it's the ln of 0.9048, because I would have divided both sides by 100, and then I have to divide the whole thing by 34. So I'm skipping a step here. Feel free to have an intermediate step in the simplifying of your equation before you get to this value of c. And this is approximately minus 0.00294. So again, notice that this is negative, which means that the actual model describes the radioactive decay in D. And this number is quite a bit smaller than this K number. So that means that ecologically, the material is decaying much slower than in lab conditions, which is consistent with the fact that there is way more of it left than predicted by the previous calculations. Now, notice that we're asked to find the ecological half-life. Half-life is the time at which there is exactly half of the amount left. So there are a couple of ways to do this. You can, again, think of R0 as being 100%, which will give you the half-life to be at 50%, or I can leave the R0 in and simply deal with the fact that half-life will occur when there is R0 over 2 amount of material that remains. So then I have e to the power of ct. C is this value we've just calculated using the real data. 294 times t. I am going to have to solve for t in this case because I am after the time at which there is only half of the material remaining. Okay, so here, just like before, notice that I can cancel R0. They're definitely not zeros, so I can divide by them throughout. And solving for t, the expression for t will be ln of 1/2 all over minus 0.00294. One thing to notice here is that although I'm dividing by a negative number, and some of you might be worried because I am solving for time, which should be positive, what is not obviously visible here is the fact that this logarithm is also a negative number. So a negative number over a negative number will produce a positive result. Plug it into your calculator, you will get 235.7 years. So indeed, a positive number that is obviously much, much bigger than the 30 years predicted in the lab. Let's take a look at the last two parts. It says, the next part says, assuming ecological constants, so the value of C, in how many years will there be 5% left of the original amount? Okay, so once again, going back to your model, this is the equation that we will use over and over again. What is asked is the time, in how many years, will there be 5% left? If I started with R0, 5% of that will be 0.05 R0, and I need to solve for time t, when there's going to be that many, using the value for c that I've already discovered. So 0.00294 times t. Once again, I can see that R0 gets cancelled, which is also why if you're more comfortable with numbers, you can plug in simply 100% and 5% here. You will get the same result. Solving for t, again, taking logarithms of both sides, will give me ln of 0.05 all over the value for c, which will be approximately 1,019 years. So not looking good for the cesium-135 in the soil. Luckily, this is not one of the most dangerous chemicals that actually have been put into the ground at the day of the accident. The last question asks to sketch the graph actually describing the ecological decay. So we're going to use all of the information and all of the points for this graph that we found above. I know that it's decaying, so my graph will be exponential decay, a function, that looks something like this. It will stay above the x-axis. This will be its horizontal asymptote. I'm going to start at some value R0 here, or 100%. So let me label this with 100%. Maybe this is all of the original amount that has been put that has exploded and has affected the soil outside of Chernobyl. I also have found a few points here. I'm using the ecological numbers. So I know, for example, that in 2020, so 34 years after, there were 90.48% left. And I know that half-life, which means there will be half of the amount left, 235 years from now. So these are the points that I can put on the graph. I also know that in 1,019 years, I'm going to have 5%. So I'm going to adjust my scale accordingly. And let's say this is going to be about 200, 400, 600, 800, and 1,000 in years. Because I can see that my biggest number will be past 1,000. So in 34 years, if this is 100, this is approximately a third, I know that there are 90.48%. So I'm about up here in terms of percentage. I know that half-life is 235 years. So in 235 years, I'm going to be halfway down, so approximately here, which means I have a point on the graph right about here that corresponds to the half-life information. And then the last point I have is that there will be about 5% left in 1,019 years. So these are the points, and I know my curve is going to be exponential decay, so I'm going to do my best to draw a reasonably smooth exponential decay looking curve. Okay, looks pretty decent. Other types of applications involve so-called logistic functions, which generally have this form. And these functions describe, in particular, the spread of disease very, very accurately. So in this question, Paul's chickens have a bird flu, and he's trying to prevent the epidemic or stop the epidemic. He models the flu with this function, where T is weeks after the initial outbreak, and this describes the number of his chickens that are sick at time T. Let's go through some of the ways to analyze this function now. How many chickens became sick when the flu epidemic has first began? So we are starting with weeks after the initial outbreak, which means that this question corresponds to the value of the function at t equals 0. And so if I plug it in, I'm going to get 300 over 5 plus 20 e to power minus 0.07 times 0. So of course, notice that e to power 0 is simply 1. So altogether, we're going to have 300 over 5 plus 20, which will give us 12. Okay, and this was chickens. So there were 12 chickens at the beginning of the outbreak. The next question asks, in how many weeks will 30 chickens be sick? In how many weeks means that we're asked about the time. And 30 chickens being sick means that the function value is actually 30. Okay, so this is asking, when is this expression? For what t is this expression equal to 30? So I'm going to have 30 equals 300 all over 5 plus 20 e to the minus 0.07 t. There are, as per usual, a number of ways to actually solve this equation, and I am going to just go about one of the ways. I can cross multiply here, realizing that this is like 30 over 1. So cross multiplying will give me 30 times 5 plus 20 e to the 0.07 t negative equals 300. Remember that at the end, I'm simply trying to isolate the term with t in it. And so this is already looking a lot better because I no longer have denominators here. Okay, I can now divide both sides by 30 to get rid of this number here, which will then result in 5 plus 20. So whatever I had in this bracket, 300 divided by 30 will of course give me 10. Now I can subtract 5 from both sides or move the 5 over there, which will result in 5 on the right hand side, and then I can divide everything by 20. So skipping one step here, I'm going to get e to the negative 0.07 t being equal to 5 over 20 or 1 quarter. Okay, so this is the same as 1 quarter. Once we have that, I can take logarithms of both sides of this equation in order to bring t down to the bottom. So taking logarithms and then dividing everything through will give me that t is equal to logarithm of 1/4 divided by minus 0.07, which when you plug it into the calculator turns out to be approximately 19.8, and the units were in weeks. So once again, please note that just because you're dividing by something something that doesn't look negative by something negative doesn't mean that you're going to get negative time as the answer. The logarithm of anything, or natural logarithm of anything that is less than e on the inside, will be a negative number. Okay, so in 19.8 weeks, there will be 30 chickens that are sick. The next question says, what is the maximum number of chickens that will become ill? And I am sure that you guys have all seen various types of disease dynamics graphs on the news. So what this is really asking is, when is the plateau happening? What will be that final number of, in this case, birds that will become ill? Or the other way to write this is, what does f of t approach if as the time goes on? And mathematically, time goes on gets transferred to time goes to infinity. Okay, so let's take a look at our expression for our function, 300 over 5 plus 20 e to the minus 0.07t. And I'm going to think about what happens to this entire expression as this value of t goes off to infinity. So I'm going to work inside out here, okay? So this t goes to infinity, which means that I have to look at what happens to this function e to the negative 0.07t as t goes off to infinity, okay? So my next step up is figuring out what this approaches. This is e to the negative x, where x represents the coefficient and the t here. So let's think about the graph for a second. The graph looks like this, right? E to the negative 0.07t, which means that as x gets larger and larger and larger, I'm raising e to the more and more negative power, which means I'm getting smaller and smaller numbers. So this here will approach zero. That's the asymptote, the horizontal asymptote. Now, 20 times 0 is just 0, so overall, I'm going to have that this entire expression approaches 300 over 5 plus 0, or 300 over 5, which of course is 60. That means that the epidemic will plateau at the 60 chickens. We're not sure that how many birds there are in total. We're not given this information, and maybe 60 is all of them, and maybe some of them turn out to be immune, and that is taken into the account by the actual model. The last part asks to sketch the rough graph of the epidemic spread, and we're going to use all of the information that we have derived above to do that. Notice that I'm only going to sketch for the positive values of t, because here it represents time, so of course it's the only the positive values make sense. So what do we have above is that the epidemic started off with 12 chickens. We also know that the maximum number of chickens that will become ill are 60, and this is what I am thinking is going to be our horizontal asymptote, or our plateau variable, because this is what happens to the function as time goes off to infinity. We've also in this part derived that there will be 30 chickens that are sick in 19.8 weeks, so that is, if this is approximately 20 weeks, that I'm going to be at 30 chickens. So this is another point on this graph that I know I have. And now, the only thing that I know about the graph is that it does approach the horizontal asymptote as time goes on. So my graph on the end behavior has to look like this. And it also has to go through these two points. The problem, of course, is this is really going to be a very rough sketch, because I don't really know what the graph looks like otherwise. Does it look like this? Or maybe it looks smoother like this all the way, or anything else in between, okay? So the information that I have so far is not quite enough to determine the accurate shape of the graph, and this is going to be something that you guys are going to do further in calculus. So all of this will be necessary to determine certain points on the graph and the general shape of it, but calculus tools will then allow you to take this one step further and recognize when the function has certain shape and which shape it has in this case. Now, this is the end of Unit 5 or Module 5, so please take a look at the Web Work Assignment 5B here, as well as a whole bunch of exercises at the end of this section that both include procedural manipulations with equations, as well as a number of modeling problems that are going to appear again in calculus.